I just want to express my extreme happiness to be introducing Carrie-Ann Biondi. Not only is Carrie-Ann a fantastic person, but she's an immensely learned person and an excellent instructor as well. She's an associate professor of philosophy at Marymount Manhattan College, and she holds a BA, two MAs, and what might interest you all, a PhD in philosophy. The PhD she got at Bowling Green State University. Her research focuses on areas like citizenship and immigration policy, virtue ethics, children's rights, philosophy of education, Socratic pedagogy, for instance, which she also practices, and the philosophy of literature. But then in her spare time, she's the co-editor-in-chief of Reason Papers, a journal of interdisciplinary normative studies. And she also teaches courses at Marymount Manhattan College in various areas of philosophy and various interdisciplinary courses in the freshman writing seminar program there. So please give a warm welcome for Carrie-Ann Biondi.
Well, thank you for your generous introduction, Will, and good morning to all of you. I'm a little overwhelmed at how packed the room is. I won't have enough handouts for the visual aid, so you may have to share between two or three people per visual aid when those come around. One answer to the question, who is John Galt, is that he is an intellectual warrior. That is, someone who takes to the field in the battle for man's mind and the freedom we all need to actualize our mind's potential. Galt is a scientist, an inventor, but he also studied history and philosophy, which is why he knew how to stop the motor of the world and go on strike against his oppressors. The making of an intellectual warrior, and we each can be one in our own way, in part requires us to know our enemies. In philosophy, Who Needs It, an address delivered to the graduates of West Point in 1974, Ayn Rand underscores this exact point. She says, the battle of philosophers is a battle for man's mind. If you do not understand their theories, you are vulnerable to the worst among them. And a battle of this kind requires special weapons. Only philosophy can provide you with these weapons. She extends further her analysis in martial terms, urging her audience to become intellectual warriors. In your own profession, in military science, you know the importance of keeping track of the enemy's weapons, strategies, and tactics, and of being prepared to counter them. The same is true in philosophy. You have to understand the enemy's ideas and be prepared to refute them. You have to know his basic arguments and be able to blast them. Objectivists take principled stands on issues that cause them to elude easy political characterization, at least in the American context where politics is cast in terms of right and left. So they are accustomed to being challenged from nearly every direction. Among those challenges is the persistent rejection of capitalism, which creates a hostile climate for business and entrepreneurship in every domain from education to healthcare. Critiques of capitalism are often driven either by ignorance or sometimes malevolent ad hominem. Especially popular tactics in either case involve visual hijacking, which pervades the popular imagination through images of capitalism as grinding exploitation, alienation, mindless superficiality, narcissism, poverty, and gluttony. We should expose these images for what they are, caricatures of capitalism. Although ultimately mistaken, some critiques of capitalism are quite deep and even thoughtful, and so should be grappled with. They depict real and pervasive problems, but ones whose causes lie elsewhere than in capitalism's productive potential of free exchange with people of value. In order to be able to set the terms for and win back discussions of capitalism, it's crucial to understand the basic premises of these critiques. This requires careful study of the works of those with whom we disagree, as well as courageous debate with those who hold such ideas. John Stuart Mill wisely recognizes in On Liberty that by knowing and engaging with our intellectual opponents, we gain at least two valuable things. One, we're able to reflect on and meet the challenges they offer. Two, even more importantly, we come to understand better the meaning of and rational grounds for the beliefs that we hold and are open to changing our beliefs if we need to. That way, we hold them independently as living truths rather than second-handedly as dead dogma. I thus identify, explain, and respond in this first of two lectures to two major critiques of capitalism, Marx and Engels' communism and Alasdair MacIntyre's conservatism. I then articulate how objectivism defends capitalism as the best hope for human flourishing. I'd like to hand out the first set of visual images. Some of these are in color. And I made more copies in black and white when I got here, when I realized the audience might be large, but not quite this large, so you're going to have to share. Those will be going around. Thank you, Will. Now, when those come around, I can hear some people have seen them already. You'll be able to take a look at the sort of visual hijacking thrown into the public's eye by Marxism. One famous image from the 1936 film Modern Times reflects the view that capitalist production turns man into a cog in the machinery. Another image from the 1999 cult movie classic Office Space depicts Milton, a marginalized 9-to-5er who is shelved and forgotten in a corner, fretting about where his stapler is. These two images are meant to show that whether capitalism is of the blue or white collar variety, it still dehumanizes man by reducing him to a dispensable means for profit maximization. We shall unravel the premises that lie behind communism's depiction of capitalism by taking a look at the essential elements of their view in Marx and Engels' The German Ideology and their more famous Communist Manifesto. So I'm going to work through the outline that you have to explain the those key premises before I then explain MacIntyre's and then how objectivism can respond to both critics. Hopefully you're all seeing the images, if you're sharing kindly. Marx and Engels see capitalism as leading to a deeply unequal outcome between the wealthy capitalist owners of the means of production, the bourgeoisie, and the poor wage laborers, the proletariat. They regard this condition as both necessary and unjust. To see why, we have to grasp their views of human nature and history. Communism recognizes that man is a physical being who must produce in order to survive, but this productive capacity is seen as an animal instinctual consciousness in an earlier stage of history when living in small social groups. It is only at a certain later stage of social development that man attains self-consciousness as what they call a species being who recognizes the world and can represent it to himself and communicate that to others. However, this is not a creative process of consciousness for them. Marx and Engels believe that life determines consciousness. That is, that economic and material forces in the world deterministically cause the contents of one's consciousness. And then one reacts in response to that content. One's consciousness cannot volitionally reshape the world. They thus have a deterministic view of human nature. This view of human nature works with their view of history, known as dialectical materialism. They think that there are stages of history that necessarily unfold over time with the growth of population and the pressures this creates to increase production. Stages of history proceed from prehistory to the ancient Roman time, where patricians are pitted against plebeians and slaves, to the Middle Ages, where feudal lords are pitted against guilds and serfs, and then to modernity, where capitalists are pitted against wage laborers. Each stage of history contains the seeds of its own destruction from economic and material processes and pressures. This destructive creation process of material circumstances is dialectical in that there's an original thesis, an antithesis, and they clash, and some kind of synthesis emerges that temporarily resolves that tension and gives birth to the next historical stage until, conveniently, the end of history arrives in the form of a communist utopia. So the stage from within Marx and Engels wrote, the class antagonism of capitalism versus, in capitalism, of the bourgeoisie versus the proletariat, is supposed to give rise to a bloody revolution. This transformation is not intentional but determined on their view. Liberation is a historical and not a mental act. The economic and material pressures of alienated workers slaving together under the same exploitative roof will lead first to unionization and then to violent revolution. where the working class overtakes the capitalists, abolish private property in favor of community ownership of the means of production, and then they create a government where the basic rule is from each according to his ability and to each according to his need. The stage will somehow transform into the communist utopia at the end of history with the withering away of the state and everybody living in this kind of barter economy as dignified equals producing their own crafted goods in natural harmony with the world and one another. Now that we see how they regard human nature and have a glimpse at their historical endgame, we can see why they view the historically necessary stages of history, including capitalism, as unjust. In short, for them, capitalism allows for highly unequal economic outcomes between people, which violates their basic egalitarianism and sets up economic power differentials that perpetuate and exacerbate this deep inequality. Radical egalitarianism is seen as man's natural condition and is the only way in which man's species being can be respected. If it takes a bloody historical path to get back to that, then so be it, they think. Capitalist free trade is seen by communists as exploitation, where the goal is to line your own pockets to the greatest extent possible by taking advantage of others' relative economic weakness. An inherent conflict thus exists for them between economic classes, and all exchange is seen as zero sum. Someone's win must be somebody else's loss. Worse still, the economic advantage that capitalists have is gained and held through the force of law. Capitalists use their power to create private property laws to own those means of production, and they create inheritance laws to protect and keep in the hands of the few what they can extort. They use that economic power differential to extort further every ounce of productivity from propertyless workers, who they page through wage slavery and make as much profit as possible beyond the laborer's intrinsic value. They regard capitalism's desire for profit maximization as insatiable and see it as necessarily becoming imperialistic through both warfare and trade. When labor and consumer markets at home have been squeezed as much as possible, capitalism extends its reach globally in search of new markets to exploit. It fabricates desires for consumer goods through manipulative advertising. This is what Benjamin Barber refers to in his famous 1995 book as the McWorld phenomenon that jihadists targeted as evil. Communists also believe that capitalist labor practices lead to workers becoming alienated in three ways: from themselves, from their products, and from people. Now, alienation is a real phenomenon, and they can occur in each of these three areas. To be alienated is to be apart from. This can happen between oneself and others when one feels no connection to other people, which leads to loneliness and isolation. It can happen between oneself and objects in the world when one cannot make sense of strange things and finds no meaning in them, such as what can happen when you look at a red dot on a white canvas and say, "What's up with that?" Stephen Hicks talks a lot about that. Such objects often become sources of ridicule or fear, making one feel lost in a hostile and absurd universe. This can happen in relation to oneself, which is the most problematic form of alienation of all. It's the bifurcation of one's psyche so that one's inner self is disconnected from one's outer self. When one does not feel comfortable in one's own skin, and you look at your life and actions as though they are performed and lived by another, that's disorienting and debilitating and can lead to loss of meaning in life and even suicide. So to accuse capitalism as being inherently alienating on every level is to accuse it of radical dehumanization that creates existential despair. So communism sees capitalism as alienating in those three ways. First, they think it's self-alienating because what you're doing is not producing goods for yourself, but for another who's going to make profit from them. And those people want you to produce whatever goods, Barbie dolls, machine guns, doesn't matter. Make money off of it, and you produce it at ever faster rates and greater quantity, even if you don't actually like the products that you're making. That leads to alienation from objects in the world, those things produced by your labor, when you don't see it as a craft that reflects who you are, but is made to turn over to somebody else, even if, just because they want it, even if they don't really need it. This in turn causes alienation from others, and not just from the capitalist, those who are supposedly exploiting you. But you see yourself as reduced to a cash value, where you exchange your alienated goods for other people's alienated goods in a dog-eat-dog world, in a low-paying job, just to survive. Okay, the next critic is Alasdair MacIntyre in Conservatism, and I got another set of pictures for you. Thank you, Will. Now, this particular set of visual images is offered as a way to hijack people by all critiques of capitalism, but especially by conservatism, particularly the religious form of conservatism, with its emphasis on denigrating the body. These images suggest that capitalism's production and consumption process leads to nothing but novelty for novelty's sake and gluttonous excess. Such images might be both enticing, depending on one's tastes, and repulsive. After all, no one person can consume a 2-foot-tall ice cream sundae, though goodness knows I've tried, or a 25-pound hamburger that gets into the Guinness Book of World Records. And really, does Paris Hilton's dog need a $5,000 diamond collar? Well, she thought so. Regardless of your estimation of the objects in these photos, they are ludicrous caricatures of capitalism. What concerns drive the perspective that fears large burgers and sundaes and spending sprees on toys for the family pet? We can see those concerns best in MacIntyre's influential 1981 book, After Virtue. MacIntyre is one of the most prominent and, I think, thoughtful moral philosophers of the 20th century. He began as a Marxist, converted to Catholicism, and produced voluminous and insightful commentary on the impoverishment of modernity. He criticizes both capitalism and classical liberalism, the classical liberalism that makes capitalism possible. Now, while you might think that Marx and Engels' atheistic communism and MacIntyre's Catholic conservatism are worlds apart, you should listen carefully for the striking similarities in their critiques of capitalism. First, conservatism is essentially tradition-bound, though such traditions are often understood and maintained through a religious lens. What gets conserved are the practices of a tradition because they are traditional. Practices and the traditions they comprise are non-rationally accepted. They're not chosen by their practitioners on their view. If someone is ever able to join a tradition, which is a possibility rejected by many traditionalists, it occurs by means of a non-rational conversion experience, perhaps an epiphany. Reason is thus relegated to the role of means and analysis, internal to a tradition, never as a way to assess the grounding of a tradition and its practices. Traditionalists are most unsettled by how capitalism embraces freedom of choice in both consumer goods and ways of living. For free choice does not guarantee the maintenance of a tradition. Why do they resist the loss of a tradition? The fear here is that meaning is lost when the practices inherent to a tradition die out at the invisible hand of market forces. And meaning by them is meant in two ways, both linguistic meaning and meaning in life, meaningfulness, or the significance of a life. Let's see how MacIntyre explains this concern. His view is a teleological one, which means that he sees human life as purposive and end-driven, with an ultimate value at the foundation to order all the rest of one's values and choices. So far, so good. Sounds like Ayn Rand's The Objectivist Ethics. Unlike most other Aristotelians, though, his teleological view is not rooted in universal human nature. Instead, he thinks that we're creatures of a community whose language and practices constitute our identity. There's no rational way of getting outside of one's tradition or language. He says, "I am someone's son or daughter, a citizen of this or that city, a member of this or that guild or profession. I belong to this clan, that tribe, this nation. Hence, what is good for me has to be good for one who inhabits those roles. These constitute the given of my life, my moral starting point." He thinks that people need a narrative structure in order to have purpose in life, That is, a life tale with a beginning, middle, and end, where the end dictates how the narrative should unfold. A tradition embodied in a community upholds practices through its institutions that pursue goods internal to that form of life. Virtues are acquired qualities that allow one to attain such goods. MacIntyre is part of the Catholic tradition, so the virtues he endorses are keyed to that tradition. Thus, one's life story, which is the source of one's meaning in life, is constructed and made possible by one's tradition and the language of that tradition. At best, we can get distorted glimpses into the traditions of others, if such glimpses are even possible. Trying to reject one's tradition leaves one rootless, wandering the spiritual desert of modernity's thin gruel, which takes us to the next element in conservatism's rejection of capitalism. Conservatives often find the material aspects of capitalism and consumption-oriented habits to be disturbing, as this draws people's attention away from matters of the spirit. By spirit, they usually mean transcendent eternal concerns of the soul that are not reducible to and are often in conflict with the physical body. Now, traditionalists who are not religious typically mean by spirit a way of life that transcends one's own life and may require the sacrifice of one's personal desires for the sake of the faceless public good. MacIntyre, in particular, thinks that one can only pursue genuine human goods in common and that goods are not private property. This is because he thinks that the private, the ego, is marked by what the Greek word pleonexia, often translated as greed. This, on his view, or the way pleonexia is really understood, is an insatiable striving for more and more material goods, overreaching to grasp the goods of others. So indulging one's personal desires is thus destructive of the public spiritual good that makes narrative structure and meaning of individual lives possible. Conservatives are thus generally big fans of censorship of media and banning of products they find inimical to their particular tradition and practices. For example, in 2001, a religious group in New Mexico cast Harry Potter books, as well as AC/DC CDs and Ouija boards to the flames of a large bonfire. Okay, so much for Back in Black. They were purging their community of satanic influences. Now, we can see that the classical liberal political value of tolerance for various, though not all, visions of the good and its protection of individual rights that is practiced, they conflict with institutionally with this view of conservatism. Capitalism and classical liberalism, on their view, divide human communities. There's no longer a shared small community of value to give meaning to one's life. Instead, it's a large conglomeration of competing values and desires that can only be navigated by rights talk as the solution to classical liberalism's moral schizophrenia. There's no longer a common good, but personal legal combat. According to MacIntyre, the classical liberalism and capitalism of modernity have also compartmentalized an individual's life by dividing the self into disconnected existential moments in a Sartrean existentialist way that only has a focus in the modern economy centered around the language of money. The self is reduced to one's salary or wage or the material objects that money can buy. One can get money, status, and power by many routes. So modern man tends to do any job that maximizes getting those goods. Thus, one's job is never a vocation governed by its own valuation with its own set of virtues, but rather it's just a job used to get those external goods of money and stuff. In order to keep workers maximizing their tasks, there are increasing levels of the bureaucratization of different business institutions where managers oversee these functions and make sure that profit is always maximized, regardless of whether or not the material goods are worth creating in the first place. Here, it's all about the Benjamins. So, objectivist responses to these two critiques of capitalism. First, challenging Marx and Engels. In responding to the challenges of communism and conservatism, I'll draw primarily upon Rand's insights, not necessarily quoting the sources, in What is Capitalism, the Conflicts of Men's Interests, and the Objectivist Ethics, as well as examples from her novels, David Kelly's The Evidence of the Senses, and Tara Smith's Ayn Rand's Normative Ethics. Occasionally, I'll mention other sources as well as suitable. So first, Marx and Engels. What's wrong with communism? The short answer is almost everything. It's not that it fails to diagnose serious social and personal ills, for it does point out some legitimate problems. Its errors come from a combination of faulty premises and in trying to pin the responsibility for certain problems on capitalism. First, their picture leaves out free will. It sees individuals as driven in a determined way by economic and material forces, driven to acquire the means of production if you are lucky, or driven to acquire wages if you are unlucky. While one might luckily inherit or gain through force and plunder some wealth, keeping it and creating more is not a matter of luck, but of free will and creative productivity. The example of Francisco d'Anconia is partly intended to illustrate this fact. He inherited d'Anconia copper, but deliberately drives it into the ground rather than allow governments to plunder its wealth. He's not going to let that happen on his watch. He'd rather have it die at his own hand in the deliberate pursuit of the strike that he morally supports. He knows that he has the ability to create anew another industrial enterprise with his ingenuity, his hard work ethic, and his free will. There's also nothing unlucky about earning wages. It's not wage slavery. One needs to take the initiative to apply for jobs and to offer certain valued skills and capacities in order to get hired in the first place, and takes even another set of skills to keep the job and to get promotions, etc. That's not luck. That takes initiative and free will. So whether inherited and maintained or earned from scratch, all of these wealth-related activities are chosen in some way, not determined. Second, Marx and Engels mischaracterize capitalism, beginning with a misunderstanding of wealth. Communism sees wealth very narrowly as tangible capital, as the means of production, by which they mean land, factories, etc., that are then given somehow a monetary value. This understanding of wealth is a result of bad metaphysics. They've gotten wrong man's nature, and as Rand notes, they have begun the causal story of wealth midstream. After all, where does the factory or tilled land come from to begin with? Why do we even create paper and coins and now plastic cards and now, you know, for those of you who are fans of Bitcoin, I'm not quite sure how that works, to use as money? I'm sure somebody's not going to tell me how it works. Communism treats capital and capitalists as goods that fall from the sky to be used like a plot of land to feed the hungry or like a stack of bricks to shelter the homeless. Man as a being of volitional consciousness possesses the fundamental means of production, his creative mind, which he must choose to exercise by his free will. He needs to choose to focus, to attend to the world, apply his reason to the natural resources of the world by his choice. Now, I can sit back and look at an apple on a tree, but that will not alleviate my hunger. I must choose to pay attention to the facts about me, my world, and the causal relationship concerning how the world can work for me. Go up and pick the apple, eat it. If I don't die, cool. It's a good start. If I do, it's the game over. Or I can make the world work with me in the case of other beings of volitional consciousness. Ultimately, the source of wealth creation is man's mind and his physical capacity to realize his ideas in action, whether wage laborer or business entrepreneur. Any disparities in amassing material wealth are both caused by and limited by an individual's choices in conjunction with the choices made by other free individuals, and that is neither unjust nor undignified. Third, we need to address the charge that capitalism is exploitative. Yes, it is. In the sense of taking advantage of opportunities for productivity and value creation. The way in which this is done makes all of the moral difference. Good capitalism exploits opportunities by means of creativity, reason, and consent. Bad capitalism isn't really capitalism, but rather predation. It exploits opportunities through force, fraud, and manipulation of the vulnerable. Marx's so-called predatory capitalist exploiter is not a person acting in his own rational self-interest. Now, anti-predation is not a deontological command, but a principle of social interaction that is in my rational self-interest, my lifespan interest. This is Rand's deep insight with the trader principle, with offering value for value through mutual consent. The trader principle is in one's own rational self-interest in part, because leaving others free to compete in markets, to be as amazing as they each can be, while being their productive selves in whatever domain they have chosen, makes possible that vastly expanding network of knowledge, goods and services that I and each one of us can benefit from so immensely. This is also in part because force, fraud, and manipulation are second-handed. That violates the virtues of rationality, independence, and honesty. Say that you're plundering the rational productivity of others. Now, once you've used them, taken what they created and destroyed them, then what will you do? How will you live? You took the fish, killed the fishermen, and you still don't know how to fish. You can stand there, hungry and dying, or think, learn how to fish, and live. Ultimately, the task of living can only be done by thinking for yourself. Contrary to what communism holds, predation is not good for capitalists, just as it is not good for their employees or the public. Proper exploitation of opportunity is good for each person. On to alienation. Now, that set of ills, when they are ills, and I think there is a sense of alienation that is in fact good, something that is indeed bad or evil, should be seen as alien. Voldemort is not of me. He's alien to me. I don't get him, and I think that's suitable because he's an evil person or an evil character in the series. But those ills of alienation cannot be attributed to capitalism properly understood. You knew I'd get the Harry Potter reference in there. Always. The causes of alienation are many, and it's not my task here to enumerate them. Some are generated by low self-esteem, poor choices, or the duplicity of others, all of which can occur under any economic or political system. So it's not an especial problem for capitalism. More importantly, it's not caused by it inherently. I would actually contend that communism inherently has far greater potential for alienation than does any other system. Being harnessed to others through socialized property arrangements is alienating, since one does not get to choose either what to produce or to whom goods should be distributed. Everyone else seems to own a part of you with nothing remaining that's yours. George Orwell's 1984 and Rand's We the Living illustrate that point. Under capitalist free enterprise, one can choose to apply for any open position or seeing no businesses out there that would suit you, choose to become an entrepreneur, start something new. These are liberating and self-chosen activities. It's true that one is not guaranteed landing any particular job or that one's enterprise will be successful, and so one might not be able to pursue that which is the top choice of one's deepest desire in their hearts. But that doesn't have to be alienating not to achieve that, as one can develop the flexibility to cultivate a variety of interests, of being able to adapt to changing markets so that one can most fundamentally partially identify with one's job in some way or other, because underneath it all, you recognize, or should recognize, I argue, that at the root of this is the mutual consent required for the trader principle. One cannot purchase the pursuit of one's dreams at the cost of another person's nightmare. Then, identifying most fundamentally with one's human nature as a free and choosing being is the anchor against alienation from self, others, and one's products. On to MacIntyre. While I think that MacIntyre's perspective has some merit in its diagnosis of ills present in modern political liberalism, I also think he's deeply mistaken in a number of ways. First, as with Marx and Engels, MacIntyre's critique results in part from bad metaphysics caused by bad epistemology. His view of the self is socially constituted and thus either locked into non-rationally grounded practices of a tradition or as locked into the irrational, endless pursuit of material goods that causes meaningless capitalist existence is a false dichotomy. Objectivists reject this view on epistemic grounds, as best seen, I think, in how David Kelly develops Rand's epistemological insights concerning direct realism. We each, have perceptual cognitive faculties that precede the process of abstraction and concept formation that lies at the root of language. We can each choose to experience the world and think for ourselves and revise our beliefs. Perception precedes language and also serves as a reality check on language uttered in our communities. This rational agency is what allows us to step outside of practices and to reflect and choose non-arbitrarily what is good for humans and what is good for me. So social identity, one's identity is not constructed socially. It can be constructed directly in one's individual relation to the world. Second, the private is not inherently about maximizing the satisfaction of whatever desires happen to be coursing through your body. Since one can directly know the world through a process of reason, you can also discern what is genuinely good for humans in general and specifically good for yourself. You might really want that 2-foot sundae, but if you're a diabetic, don't eat it. It's called self-control and an interest in long-term survival in good health. So goods can be private and individually experienced as good for me. Flourishing as man qua man is the human good, but the very specifics of how I flourish as an embodied being in the world are highly individualized and can only be realized in my lived experience, not dictated by or fit into pre-existing cultural narratives. Yeah. There are some individuals, perhaps many, who choose to pursue any and all objects of their desire. So yeah, under capitalism, you get to see the likes of Paris Hilton on extravagant shopping sprees and the creation and consumption of massive hamburgers. Those are possible outcomes, but they should be tolerated, even welcomed, alongside the innumerable benefits only achievable under capitalism. We should make sure, though, that overindulgent consumers bear the costs of their choices rather than imposing them on the costs of others. That, to me, would seem to be the reasonable way to accommodate any externalities that might be generated by that. Third, individual rights should not be rejected so long as there is a proper grounding made for them. Upholding rights to life and private property are the instrumental common good that makes possible the creation and enjoyment of human goods, not the cause of division or dysfunction, as MacIntyre maintains. At the foundation of Rand's rational ethical egoism is the choice to live, which then requires, as noted already, that one chooses to use one's rational faculty to figure out how to do that in relation to one's nature. And it is one's own life that is the proper object of ethics. One is the ultimate beneficiary of one's actions, though others may benefit from your self-interested choices, and though you may see relationship with certain others as constitutive of the value of your life, not some stepping stone on the achievement of happiness, but a constitutive part of what makes happiness a reality and not an abstraction. This is akin to Aristotle's function argument in his Nicomachean Ethics. Rand substantially builds on his insights, though. She provides a deep grounding for liberty and individual rights in human nature that makes sense out of the values that are at stake and the virtues required to obtain those values in a way that Aristotle never did, unfortunately. I think he's really great, but didn't quite go all the way on this one. Being free from coercion allows one to use the knowledge acquired through one's efforts and the rational use of one's mind, so as to obtain the secure possession and use of property in that we need to flourish. So Rand's theory is able to justify capitalism on a firm and moral footing. My last objection, an objectivist response to MacIntyre, is that, yeah, some people might confuse means and ends and pursue money for its own sake, stack it up in a special room like Ebenezer Scrooge before he had his epiphany. Objectivism rejects MacIntyre's bifurcation of the material and the spiritual. It also rejects his view that capitalism stymies man's ability to obtain spiritual values. The proper pursuit of one's individual good is deeply spiritual if one means by that, as I do, that you attend to cultivating a virtuous character out of reverence for your life and your experience of it. So let's take a brief look at the example of Howard Roark to see this. He's one of my very favorite characters in all of fiction. Howard insists on operating by capitalism's trader principle, yet he is no profit maximizer. He's a value optimizer. One might end up maximizing profits by optimizing value, but the two should not be confused with one another. Howard chose to endure poverty rather than compromise on value creation, the latter being beyond the price of rubies. If he could not pursue architecture on his own terms by means of integrity, then it would be far better to be a monetarily poor man working in a quarry, rich in spirit. Only when like-minded people of character recognize his worth and his work, and they find him and they freely trade with him on his terms, will Howard return to the world of architecture with a clear conscience and his highest values achieved. Here, Rand shares Aristotle's view that it's far more important to help a friend fight for his character than for his property, since the former is far more valuable than the latter. A system of capitalism is thus not soul-crushing or anti-spiritual, but rather allows for the freest possible pursuit of individual fulfillment and flourishing. So, when distilling the essentials of the critiques of capitalism from any direction, a few persistent themes emerge. Capitalism dehumanizes, degrades, exploits. Capitalism is to blame for mindless consumption and thoughtless neglect. Capitalism is undignified and unjust. That's what happens when you let challengers define your terms for you. It is crucial to know your metaphysics, epistemology, and ethics in order to justify your economics, law, and politics. Ask yourself, what is the self? How do I know that? What is good? Be clear in your own responses to these questions and reframe debates over capitalism on your terms. In taking back the content of your concepts, you reclaim capitalism properly understood and properly defended on the only fitting foundation, a moral foundation. Thank you.
Absolutely terrific presentation. Thank you for that. A point Rand made repeatedly, and I wonder how it fits in here, is if you focus on the Marxist and the MacIntyrean critiques, what's interesting is that they appear to refute themselves. Capitalism simultaneously generates poverty, but it generates excessive wealth. It simultaneously generates alienation, but also generates self-indulgence and excessive concern for the self. And all of that raises this question, what's the chicken and the egg here? Do people generate theories which then yield for them anti-capitalist conclusions, or is the unifying theory here there's some deeper dislike of a capitalist system, and then from every different direction, whichever direction happens to work, one then generates the theory that yields those conclusions? Just that they seem to be coming at it from every possible direction, contradicting each other in the process. Just a sociological observation about the history of ideas.
Thank you. That actually helps me think of a more nuanced way of responding to them. There is something I think that both of these critiques hold in common that is going to come out most explicitly in part two of the talk, where I'm going to focus only on John Rawls's welfare liberalism. And I'm going to explicitly talk about the role of envy there. So I think there is something that they share in common that I didn't name here that is important, that drives their rabid hatred of capitalism. You said, though, that it generates, you think it's self-refuting because it generates what sound like contradictions, but I think I could see how they could respond to your concern in the following way on both counts that you mentioned. You said that they're accusing it of being both self-alienating yet also excessively focused on the self. But the thing is that they're actually two different phenomena to prize apart. They think that you're being alienated from your true self. And that's very different from the self-involvement of narcissism. And so the word self in there's an equivocation between the two concepts. So they would say, well, actually, it's not a contradiction because the concepts are not equivalent. Yes, exactly, false consciousness, which basically means the consciousness you hold when you don't agree with me. the other issue about it generating, that it creating, being the cause of poverty and also creating extreme wealth, also they would say, well, for different populations, that the wealth is generated or falls into the lap of the few who create laws that make sure it's entrenched in those few and it doesn't leave their hands or the hands of their successors who they're going to leave it to, but it creates great poverty for the vast bulk of the population. And it's that, and so they and this also I'll speak about when I talk about Rawls tomorrow morning. They assume that there's a rigid way in which people fall into socioeconomic categories that's not, there's no mobility. And the very little mobility is at the margins. It's actually, the view is much more nuanced than my summary reveals, because he talks about the bourgeoisie and the extremely concentrated wealth in like the 1%. And then there's the petty bourgeoisie who are like the merchants and stuff who are jealously guarding the more that they have that keeps them above the poverty, the subsistence line that the wage laborers work and earn and work. So it's a complex system, but they see that when people are in the category, they don't really move, except for the few people with the margins between the wage laborers who are like barely surviving, and the merchants who are just over the margin, but who are trying to get and keep as much wealth as they can as merchants, or small business owners, not to fall into that lower category. So that's the only place where they see people might go back and forth with extreme poverty, or maybe if they're lucky, they'll get to own their own little shop. Yeah, that's how they'll respond to what you're saying. Okay.
She's worried not about the 0.1%, but about ordinary, normal people being distracted by the wealth.
And that's that, yes.
Macintyre's perspective on that is different from. Macintyre's not worried about the impoverishment of the 99%, quite to the contrary.
True, although
Could you repeat the question?
Oh, that he thinks that MacIntyre's critique is very different from that extreme wealth disparity I was talking about. That's true, but he also, and I think this is his lingering Marxist hangover, is that he wants to reject rights theory and big state structures that require classical liberalism to run such a big system. He's in favor of small anarchic communities. His ideal is a fishing village in Scotland, where he's from. And he thinks his ideal community would be small pockets of religious communities where there are no schisms, and basically people live and produce close to the land or the water if they're fishermen, and produce just enough that they need to live and perpetuate their traditions with their families, and it's very Amish-like in its closeness. So his ideal is the communist utopian ideal, and when people live in large modern states, the concern I spoke to that I think I was handled by the first one about distinguishing between two understandings of the self is where his largest challenge explicitly resides, that you're alienated from your true self under these big glitzy structures that have you distracted by, I have to have the latest update on this electronic device. And he's like, yeah, but that distracts you from, you know, contemplation of your place in the cosmic order. Oh, another question.
Yeah, so I may not be able to state this as clearly as I want to, but one of the problems I have, and I think we have when discussing issues like this, is capitalism. Well, first of all, this wasn't even a term made up by people who are capitalists. This was made up by Marx, right?
Correct.
And people use the word capitalism in such a loose manner that it's very hard to have a discussion with them. And so some people have said, well, I want to use the word free market instead, but that's not exactly what we mean either oftentimes. And so how do you, I know how I've begun to deal with this, but I mean, if, you know, people think we deregulated the economy and we're living in a capitalist economy, and I'm going, well, we can't have a discussion because our terms don't have, we're not using the same terms. Anyway, your thoughts.
No, that's a great point, and actually I struggled with this a bit. Like, because capitalism comes from Marx and Engels' understanding of capital, and had this massive work, three-volume Capital, which is I've never made my way entirely through, I must say. There's a lot of stuff I haven't read, and so but the distillation of their essential views is in the two works that I was synthesizing and summarizing here, The German Ideology and Communist Manifesto. And so Capital, that very specific sense of, you know, it's like objects in the world, physical, tangible objects, and who's got that stuff? That, and so capitalists are those who amass that and try to keep that. Like, and so without, on their view, they're not even thinking about where does that come from? How does this get made? What's required to produce it? So to use their term, I could see, but since it's gotten to common parlance and ran, you know, capitalism, the unknown ideal. It's like, I'm working with, at least in this context, and perhaps I shouldn't for broader audiences, Rand reclaims that like she reclaims the term selfishness and such, that what really self means, and this is not a new thing. Aristotle distinguishes between good and bad conceptions of the self, and he defends the real self as you're identifying primarily with your rational intellect in embodied fashion as a hylomorphic being, on his view, an embodied person in the world with a mind and a reasoning faculty. And so she goes back to Aristotle's insight there and talks about the virtue of selfishness in the right way. Capitalism, the unknown ideal, the right ideal. So I'm using her understanding, and I don't call it free markets, I call it free enterprise, but in the context of the legal and political institutions that are necessary to make that freedom possible, like laws against force and fraud, protection of contracts, etc., that enable the trader principle to operate. So it's not an anarchic situation that makes it possible. Your point is really well taken, and I'm just going to, for them now, provisionally operating with Rand's understanding of free enterprise.
Yeah, and
if anybody can give me a really good, robust definition of capitalism that doesn't just use Rand's generic understanding, that would be great.
So I certainly wasn't meaning in any sense to criticize your use of the word capital. I'm just saying this mm-hmm. is a problem when we're having a discussion. And in
yes.
fact, I think it is a mislabeling, because in fact, what took off in the Industrial Revolution had nothing, very little to do with capital. What it really had to do was the freeing of the mind to create new technologies. And so in that sense, I think it's a mislabeling. Which goes to my talk for
I wish I wasn't. Okay, no, I understand.
Catch the video on the Atlas Summit website in about a month.
I'm going to have to, it sounds like. No, that's really great. So this has to do with larger cultural conversations, which is actually what, because and that's a fair thing to push me on, because I contextualize this not just for this audience, but that it behooves us as intellectual warriors in the larger fight for freedom to be able to talk to people of all different stripes intellectually. And that requires knowing their different views. And not being afraid to confront them and being like, oh no, I'm going to get infected with Marxism. Now she's talking about alienation. And yeah, well, it's a real phenomenon. Why not talk about it? Yeah, there are poor people. Why not talk about it? What are the real causes? If you're reality oriented, then you should go there and read the stuff that people defend on their own terms and get clear on what going on there, and then so you don't talk past each other to say, well, I know that you're using this concept in this way, or it sounds like you are, could you clarify that? And invite them to clarify their terms if you think you're talking past each other. Otherwise, you're just a couple of Rams button heads, and that's not productive of changing anyone's mind. And my whole, this is contextualized epistemologically, of being able to converse and understand and to persuade on rational grounds. So thank you for reminding me about the need to do that. I really genuinely appreciate it. Thank you. Next question.
Hi, I'm Jackie Hazleton. I wanted to ask you about competition. I know you mentioned dog eat dog, but you didn't really say much else about competition. And I'm wondering if part of the problem is the horrible fear of competition and not coming out, not being up to the competition and being able to compete. And that's one of the reasons why people are afraid of capitalism.
are?
Oh, that's a great question. And I don't mean to fob this off yet again to my talk tomorrow morning, but I will partly do so and partly address your question frontally. Rawls as well for liberalism is very much like these views are about trying to guarantee a certain outcome that they think everyone must share. So being afraid of not being up to the snuff of competition means that you want a job guaranteed. And so, of course, the objectivist response is there isn't and there shouldn't be any such guarantee. But that the proper response, I think, is at least twofold, probably more so, but this is what is occurring at the moment. One of them is that under capitalism, at least it gives you the best odds of trying to handle competition, of being able to explore different interests, to find where your talents lie, to work with people to help draw that out of you, to bring out the best in yourself, and to be able to offer something. I mean, life coaches, for goodness sake. I mean, they're there to help you adapt flexibly to the vicissitudes of fortune and other people's choices. So I think so. One more broad point is that if you're afraid of being up to the snuff of competition, capitalism is exactly the best system to be under for that, because there's so much creative opportunity to develop things and create your own market niche if you don't fit into something that already exists. The other has to do with understanding the benefits of competition. And I don't know if this was part of your question or if I've already sufficiently addressed it. Sometimes people think they're entitled to a very particular outcome, and if they don't get that, their interests are not served. And that's thinking too short term. And so your interests are served by a system that allows you to compete freely. And so what if you don't get this particular job? Guess what? Another door might open, and maybe that was an even much better one than this one you'd had your heart set on. You can't foresee that, and so it's in your long-term rational self-interest to have that opportunity available. And if you don't get this job, try for another one. If you had gotten it, that's awesome, and the process would have allowed that, too, as an open possibility. And so to think that you're short-term fashion entitled to this, or it's all over, I'm going to languish and die, my life will never have meaning, is really short-sighted. And so that's the range of things that I might say to somebody who would bring up that sort of question. Did I address your question? Okay, good.
This will probably be the last question.
Hi. I was just curious about trying to explore the concept of the self a little bit more, because you pointed out that the self could be the embodied person, so a certain rational consciousness embodied. However, that sounds fairly interchangeable. Like any human being therefore could be defined as that self. But then how is Carrie-Ann Biondi different from Jerry Johnson? And therefore, there seems to be a certain weakness in our understanding and therefore a defense of capitalism from a launchpad of the self and the ownership of the self. Because it sounds to me, as a very reasonable point of view, that the self would therefore be a constellation of labels and identities that you kind of acquire accidentally or through choice as you grow up in society. So why is it difficult for us to say, to grant the idea that the self is constituted by social labels?
Ah, okay. First I'm going to sell something that I know is an idea. I hope Will doesn't mind my bringing up. But we had this really awesome online seminar discussion once a month, and a couple months back we did one on the self and objectivism.
It's the TAS Research Workshop. If you're a graduate student or professional scholar and you're interested in participating in those, email wthomas@atlassociety.org.
But more importantly, we actually grappled with exactly your constellation of questions in this amazing 90-minute discussion on the self and objectivism, and I'd like to hold a conference on that topic and have solicit a call for papers, because a lot of work needs to be done on it. So I this is an informal way of announcing that I intend to help be part of that in some way or other, whether it's through TAS or my own institution at Marymount Manhattan. Okay, so going back to your basic question of the self, you say it sounds like it's too thin and interchangeable, but by dint of the fact that your rational faculty is not this disembodied floating thing, it's this is the term I used before I threw out, it's a technical term, hylomorphism, is that it's a way of talking in words of multiple aspects of the same being. So our consciousness can't survive or emerge apart from our physical systems. It emerges from them, and when we die, I think it's over, to the best of my knowledge. You're always embodied as an intellect. It's not as this separate thing that operates separately from it. So your point's well taken about there being influences, right? You're taught a certain language. You watch certain patterns of behavior that your family and friends or people around you are engaging in. And you drink this in. Children are mimetic, and they copy. And they resist, right? They can't forget. One of the first words kids learn is no. So they both absorb and resist. And as they get older, they get a greater sense of volition over the absorption and resistance, so that it's not just taken in and knee-jerk reaction, but that you're become an agent, ideally, and to certain degrees everybody does, that you can't renege on the steering wheel unless something's radically, deeply wrong with the biological system. So your point's well taken, but I would block it by saying you can be influenced but not determined by things around you. You can exercise that radical essential self that has volition to reshape the content according to what you can reflect on as the good. So lots of work needs to be done, though. It's just a very short answer.
Well, thank you, Professor Biondi, and thank you all for coming.
And thank you all for your awesome questions and for showing up. Have a wonderful rest of the conference.